guys, how are you doing this evening?
Doing great.
Yeah, doing great.
Fantastic.
Good. Good to hear. This is Dennis, TK, and Koltin from Kinson Key Games, and they have a wonderful game called Galactic Cruise that they've been showing for at least a year now. We were just talking about how they showed it off at Tantrum Con last year. They're going to be returning with that. They have gained a number of followers. I know that there's a lot of buzz around the game at Gen Con. So good to see that. Good to see that it's continuing to get interest. You had a booth at PAX too. Said hi real quick there. So yeah, they are the owners of the company and designers of the game together. How does that work with the three of you? Like, how'd you meet?
That's a good question. To answer the first question, how does it work? It's great. Having three people versus one, I would always recommend, because I know a lot of designers going into Kickstarter, you know, they're doing it themselves. It's a lot of work. But as far as meeting, Colt and I grew up together. So we currently live 45 minutes away from each other. We used to live maybe 5 minutes. And so both of our parents attended the same church. And so we kind of grew up in youth group together at that church and then stayed friends throughout school and college and everything. And then we met Dennis, or I met Dennis at Proto ATL in 2022. And so that was the first time Dennis, like, he walked into the convention. I think we played one game. And then I walked in, I set up Galactic Cruise. He sat down, played Galactic Cruise. And he was like, I want to devote my life to this. And then that's not really how it happened, but slow progression. But we met at Proto ATL. So.
Very cool. Very cool. I mean, that's interesting for somebody to say, and this wasn't in the questions we prepared, but let's just talk about that for a second. Like, if somebody's like, hey, this is cool, I want to work on this with you. Tell me more about that. How did that go?
Yeah, Dennis, you can kind of talk about that.
Yeah. So the first part was absolutely accurate that TK mentioned. I had played one game. It was a small trick-taking game, which actually ended up getting published. So that's cool to see. And then a guy I was playing with, the first person I met, Josh, he was like, TK's got a great game. You should play it. And I was like, okay. So I went down, played Galactic Cruise, and I really did like the game, but I wasn't like trying to be involved from then. It was just TK and I became really good friends along with Mark. And we basically just hung out the whole rest of the convention. And then, you know, I met Koltin later because I knew that he was the part of this, and he was supposed to be at Proto ATL originally, but his wife had just had a baby, something like that. So he had to cancel last minute. So we just connected on a personal friend level. Like, we were just liked designing, liked playing games, and just spent a bunch of time together doing the convention. And then afterwards, so TK was like, hey, you should join our Discord server. There's other designers out there that playtest. So I had brought three different games to Proto ATL, and TK played all three of them, if I remember correctly. He played all three of them at Proto ATL, and I was like pitching and stuff like that. So I was doing my own thing, but all my playtesting that I had done was just like in person with my local game group. That I have a game group that meets every week at my house. And so I just done all my stuff through there. So TK was like, hey, you should go into Discord and check that out. So I was like, okay. So I started meeting with all sorts of other people. And in the process, like, I playtested Galactic Cruise a bunch more with them online. And it just kind of developed from there. Like, one thing that I really enjoyed was, like, after a playtest, I would usually stay late afterwards, and we would just talk, the three of us. And we were just talking about game design, but specifically Galactic Cruise, how to solve different problems in it. And I just really liked that process of having somebody else to like bounce ideas off of and work on problems together and stuff like that. So just really enjoyed that whole process. And so over time, we just kind of naturally grew into, hey, why don't we actually make this official and, you know, start the company and get everything going and go all in, sort of thing. But it just started as they had a cool game. We became friends and I just liked playing it and grew to really like the collaborative process of designing, because I'd always just done stuff myself pretty much. So Met a whole lot of other designers in that process as well, but stuck with, you know, this was the game and the team that I felt the most connection with.
Very cool. Well, why don't you, rather than answer, I kind of generally ask people like why a game, but why don't you each tell me what brought you to game design kind of briefly, maybe starting with Koltin.
Yeah, so I feel like our entire lives, TK and I have been making stuff, right? Like as kids, you know, we would try to make recipes in his parents' kitchen, which, you know, 25 years later, they still remind us of all the disgusting things we've made. But yeah, we tried to make short films. We tried to make feature length films. We tried to write an opera at one point, I think. We've always both been creators, collaborative people. So in the past, like back high school, college, we dabbled in making games for our friends. But then when the world shut down for an indiscriminate amount of time, early days of the pandemic, TK was like, we should make a game. And I was like, let's do it. I mean, I'm sitting in my house. We had just had our first baby. So I'm like, mainly what I'm doing is sitting at my house, rocking this baby. I can probably help you out there. So we came up with it's like a small card only game, just to play with each other. Cause we were kind of potting up, right? It's like, you know, in those early pandemic days, right? Like we see our family and each other. So if we get sick, you know, we know who got us sick. So we got together, we played this game. We're like, this is pretty good. So we started showing it to some of our other friends. And we just really fell in love with that process of like making stuff. As we made it, we played more of it, right? We've started playing other published games. Because up till then, we thought it was Catan, Carcassonne, Ticket to Ride, right? Those are the three games ever made. And then we discovered there's this big wide world of other games. And as we played them, we realized that we've really found ourselves in this like medium to heavy complexity, like meaty decisions, Euro style gaming. And then, so from there, kind of our little card only game was fun. We actually ran a small Kickstarter, about 100 backers. Our goal was like $2,500. We raised $3,400, which was enough to print the game, send it out, and buy exactly two steaks afterwards. But we loved the whole process of like bring something to fruition, getting it sent out, people receiving it. So we're like, well, let's do that again, but bigger. So we probably went through, I don't know, a dozen games in various like states of development. Mm-hmm. And then TK one day in 2021, texted me and said, I got this idea for a space travel, or like a space vacation game. But cool, let's add it to the list of a dozen other things we're doing. And it was immediately different. We're like, this could be the one. And that's kind of how Galactic Cruise was born out of this. But yeah, we've just kind of always been making stuff. And this is kind of the one that we have kept at.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so that it kind of answers it for the two of you. How about you?
Yeah, same story for me.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like you two have spent a lot of time together over the years. Mm-hmm. How about you, Dennis? What brought you to try game design? Was it just enjoying games as a hobby too, or something else?
Yeah, it was definitely more enjoying games as a hobby. I do have like a similar sort of story to them in terms of I used to make board games as a kid. And I mean, they were basically the types of games that I knew, like Roll and Move with cards. And I did add, I remember my games always were extra complicated. I would add like lots of upgrades and weapons you could get and modified dice rolls and things like that. So I guess I was into that a little bit as a kid, but it didn't really carry over much later. Like it wasn't like I've been making board games since then. I did do stuff like that as a kid. And then later on, so like it basically took me sort of 15 years of hardcore game playing. Like we played basically every week with my game group and got really into all sorts of games. Like I would, I love heavy Euros, but I also love, Ameritrash type things or like tactical games or dungeon crawlers, that sort of thing, as well as some party games and lighter games too. So I was really into all those games and I didn't immediately jump in and be like, oh, I should make one or I could do this. So I think it's really great actually, because like so many other designers that I meet, including TK and Koltin, they're like, I played three things. I'm a game designer. And I'm like, wow, you just like jumped in, you know? And like, they're great. And, maybe I could have made that leap earlier, but I just never even occurred to me to like try to get into it until I had played like a ton of stuff, like literally, probably more than 1,000 games or something. So I kind of came at it from a different angle. The way that I looked at it, I originally didn't set out to do like a Euro game because Euro games to me, I was like, I love them. And I loved all the designs and all these different games and stuff. And I didn't think like I could do that better. I was like, I could probably make one, but like, would it be better? I don't know. But so the first game that I made was like a dungeon crawler game because I saw that as like there's a lot of different. And I mean, over time, things have kind of converged, like the Ameritrash Euro style, like everything's kind of combined these days, like the things that people like about both sides. There's a lot more hybrid type games now. But there was a couple things that I didn't like about a lot of dungeon crawlers was line of sight systems where if you ever have a question about whether you have line of sight to something else. Like I wanted to create a system where there was never a question, even if it ended up being a little simpler. There was that sort of thing. And then tracking health on monsters and stuff like that. So I created a game where that solved those problems. And so that was kind of my first thing. And I just was doing it for fun. I didn't think that I was going to do this as like a job or anything like that. I had gone to a couple protospiels as a play tester with my brother, because he had designed a game and was working on stuff. And so I had been to a couple protospiels in Minneapolis. And so I met designers and everything. And while I was there and I enjoyed giving feedback on other people's games and seeing that whole process, but I was just going just for fun as a player. But then some people there were kind of like, why don't you bring a game next time? And so then I, end up making that game. I brought it, and a, fairly well-known publisher was like, hey, you should pitch this game. And I was like, what does that mean? Like, I had no idea. Like I didn't even, so I looked into everything and, Proto ATL was the place to go, in my mind. And I mean, it turned out to be the place to go. It was great, to like kind of learn. Like, how do I meet with publishers? How do I pitch to them? Because this publisher really liked it, but it wasn't their style. Like, it wasn't the type of game that they would sign or make. Like, just seeing it get, good feedback and, like, maybe this could be something. And so then I went to Proto ATL. Of course, I was originally supposed to go in 2020, and it didn't happen until 2022. But it all worked out in the end. So that's kind of my journey here. I was a lot slower to get here, but here we are.
So, I mean, that's interesting that TK and Koltin had been working on it for a while then at that point, right? When you started working with them, how did that change the trajectory of the game then? How did that affect the type of game that Galactic Cruise is, having a third person?
Yeah, so I think we had been working it for about a year when I took it to Proto-ATL, because we started it in May of 21. And then Proto-ATL, I think, was April 22. So we've been working on about a year. And I remember going to Proto-ATL that year and being like, all right, the game is done. This is a great game. It's done. People are going to love it. And then, of course, it changed a million times after that. But yeah, we loved Dennis as a playtester. Like, he always had a lot of great feedback. And so kind of, as he mentioned, like, it was a slow process of, you know, playtester to more of a developer who helped us work through the playtesting issues we had. To then we just felt like he had enough DNA in the game that we felt like putting his name on the box was appropriate as a designer. And so, like, from the beginning, it was always back and forth with me and Koltin. But then having that third person, Dennis, come in, I would say, I guess by the time it launches, it will have been like 30-40% into the process when Dennis joined. It's like at this point, it feels like he's been around the whole time. Mm-hmm. And he's had so much input into the game. And so it's been great.
So related to that playtesting and development, to dig into it more, what types of changes have you seen since, let's say, May 2022 until, you know, June 2023, when you're getting ready to take this to Gen Con and all that? Where were some of the major changes? Like, were there mechanical changes? Was it layout? Like, what was going on there?
All of the above.
okay.
Yeah, I think maybe I'll pick a change that I can think of, and then Colin probably pick a change. Sure. Or Dennis, everybody can pick a change. I think one of the biggest things, kind of overarching shift that we saw, was complexity and theme and how that was integrated. I think from the beginning, like, you know, we really wanted the theme to be heavy in the game, right? Like, it started as the theme started with the game. And so we wanted everything to be thematic. But I think early on, we weren't as good at tying things mechanically to the theme. And so there was a lot of shift, especially from then, of adding things and taking things away to get rid of kind of the fat that a lot of designers say, just trimming the fat, but then adding it back in, but in a thematic way so that it makes sense. And so there was a lot of that in the process. Like, we pulled out a lot of things and then added them back in a more thematic way. And one example I can think of right now is what we used to call flight plans, I believe. And that would have been a trip that you would schedule. Like, if you're going, I think it originally started out as like a 3, 6, 9, and 12 month journey. And then we changed it to weeks. And so it was probably weeks when Dennis played it, because there were like these guests, 2, 4, 6 week guests that could go on it. And so that kind of got removed and then added back in as cruises that the guests would book. And so we removed that system, or kind of not necessarily removed it, but, you know, got it down to the bare bones, to where it was literally, you launch a shuttle, it's gone for a certain amount of time, and then it comes back, and nothing happened with the ship while it was gone. There was nothing interesting about booking it. The guests were just little tokens. They didn't really have any kind of thematic value. And so there was a lot of push and pull with that, especially once Dennis joined on, of making that more thematic. I think I would say it's probably more complicated now than it was, like, that system. But it's so much more thematic that it's much easier for players to understand, even though it is more complex.
That's cool. Related to all that, what is the most fun that each of you have had as far as working on the game? Is there a particular thematic element or a visual element or mechanic that you would say, like, that's my, I can see my touch on that part of the game, and you really enjoy that?
So there's, I mean, there are parts that I could say, oh, that's mine. But when you first started asking the question, the thing that came to my mind, the most fun part for me, is every time I play the game, I am given a challenge to break it in some way. So people that play test with me usually end up, I kind of got a reputation of breaking things.
Dennis always wins, and he can break games. Like, that's his.
So basically every time I have to win, but it's like, I'm not allowed to build small shuttles, or I can only build small shuttles, or I'm not allowed to do this, or I can only do that, or whatever. So I really enjoy trying to find ways to score lots of points in a wide variety of ways. And, you know, that's really helped improve the game to help fix those. But also it's just like a really fun thing for me to try to do. And the fact that, you know, I've played over 100 times and I'm still like excited about every time that I play. It's just great to like try all these different things, but also that the game is still fun even after playing it so many times. So
it's, I feel like we've had a number of discussions after those games to where if something felt overpowered or broken, we had to decide if that was the game or it's just because Dennis is incredible and try to balance that out. And so that's been, you know, interesting and fun to see. I know Koltin can speak to a lot of specific things he's got in the game.
Yeah. Well, and one more thing about Dennis is like, it's so interesting. It's like the game must be perfectly balanced if Dennis can win it, no matter what we ask him to do. It's like build big shuttles, build small ones, spend all your money, hoard all your money. You know, it's like, right. It doesn't matter. He's just that good of a player, but also I think it also speaks to the, like the balance that we've struck in the game. That you can sit down at the table, do whatever you want within reason, and still have a shot at winning, which I think is exciting for players. As for me, my favorite like thing in the game, the thing that I'm like, I don't know, that I thought my DNA is kind of all over, is a lot of the ebb and flow of the game. So in Galactic Cruise, there are several places on the board where you can take things and it does not replenish. But there is an action where another player can come along and replenish that thing to get bonuses. So kind of breaking away from that Euro game stereotype of like, oh, it's multiplayer solitaire. There's no interaction. Or if the word interaction is used in a game, it's normally negative. It normally means combat or take that. Instead, it's a whole lot more of have this than take that. It's like, hey, I'm going to deplete these resources, but now TK's turn, he can come and fill them back up and get paid for it. I think that's cool. I also think it's just cool how like different games have like given us inspiration. And it's not always games that are in like the same weight class. So like TK and I played Cascadia, I can't remember where we were, Tantrum Con maybe. Cascadia, you know, fairly light kind of family weight game. Mm-hmm. But it has this entangled decision of what is it? It's like there's like three tiles and four tiles and four tokens, and you take a pair of them. Mm-hmm. And like I liked Cascadia. I wasn't like, oh, this is game of the year, but I was like, I like this. But I love that decision of like, I get to take a pair of these things, but I don't get to break the pair unless I spend an acorn or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. So like taking that system and using it for our, when you take a new cockpit and engine, you take a pair of them. Mm-hmm. And the cockpit's going to give you a form of scoring and the engine's going to give you an immediate bonus. And the way those come out are really interesting. I like looking at the game and being like, I remember when we added that. I kind of remember like, what were we playing when we had this idea? How did we take this little light game mechanism and put it into our kind of much heavier game? I think that's cool. And I can't remember because it was not my idea, but someone, one of these two, had the idea of the recall turn not being a dead turn. And in fact, being a pretty cool thing. So if one of you wants to jump in and take credit for it,
I think that's one of my favorite things. Or I'm going to give Dennis credit because I don't think that was me.
I don't remember either for that one.
Maybe it was a playtester. It could have been just a,
or it could have been one of those ones where we all kind of said the same thing, or I was about to say that, you're about to say that, or it's just a collaborative thing. I honestly don't remember for that one.
Yeah, I think my biggest mechanical thing that I enjoy most in the game is probably the bumping system and how the action selection works with your developments between them. The game started out more as just a standard worker placement, kind of like viticulture. And as Colton mentioned, as we learned and played these new games, we took elements that we liked and kind of forged them into it. So like when we started working on the game, we had never played a Vitalis Arta game. And so that DNA of his games worked its way in, you know, midway towards the end, because we hadn't experienced those. And once we had experienced those, we felt like we could incorporate some of these really cool concepts and ideas. And so the first worker placement game I ever played was Viticulture. And so that's how this game started out. You place a worker, you do the thing, that was it. And then one day I text Colton, I was like, I think everything's about to change. And I drew a little map, had location, all the locations, and then in between them, you could build these buildings and they would connect the locations together. And I took a picture of that drawing and I was like, I think everything's about to change. And from that moment on, the game really felt like it had that mechanical hook, right? That set it apart from all the other worker placement games. And so like, as far as my contribution, I feel like that's something that like, I really enjoy playing with, and it was cool to see the game kind of shift when we instituted that.
That's cool. So are you, it sounds like you all continue to play things. Sometimes people get stuck in a rut. What's the weirdest thing that you have all played recently?
So I wouldn't say weird.
Okay.
But it was weird how bad it was. And that was Wordle the party game.
Okay.
First of all, it's a party game with maximum 4 players. That's bizarre. The whole thing just feels really cheap and like underbaked. Like it's literally, I mean, I guess it's probably what you'd expect. You're playing Wordle, except one person is just showing you what's right and what's wrong. So there's 3 different games of Wordle going on at the same time, and one person is just giving them the answers, like showing them which letters are right, which ones aren't.
Was this by the New York Times? Is like that?
Yeah.
Of course it is.
But,
okay.
But like, it was. I couldn't believe. Like, I didn't expect it to be good. Like, we didn't even buy it. My wife did one of those. Like at work, they did one of those gift exchange things, and so she ended up with this game, and so we played it just on Saturday. After a game of Galactic Cruise, which was much better game. So we played this game and like, I didn't even expect much, but it was like worse than I could expect. They don't even give you enough stuff in the box. It's weird. It says on the front, like as if it's some feature, it's like, it has 3 dry erase markers. And it's like, well, it could really use 4 because one player has to like write down the secret word. So you have to borrow something and they don't get a player screen either. So they have to hide behind something else while they're writing. Like it just, the whole thing feels so like a cash grab. Like they're like, how can we make this as cheap as possible and just get people to buy it? Anyone that likes Wordle. So do not recommend that game. Even if you're a fan of Wordle, I don't think you'll enjoy that game.
I mean, fiction, I think is a much, much better way of implementing Wordle
I have fiction as well, because I have playtest a few times with Peter and he's a fun guy, so I did get fiction, and that I would, yeah, if you're into Wordle, rather I'd recommend fiction, not the actual Wordle game. The party game is so weird that it's only for 4 players. That was anyways.
All right. How about you guys?
Let's see.
I was going to let you go. I thought you might have something.
I was going to say, I mean, you and I, plus our wives and another friend of ours, we played that that Full Sun game. It's a trick-taking game where the backs of the cards are different. Like, the backs of the cards show what the suit is. So it's like, you know if someone can follow or not. But you follow not the suit that was led, but the last suit that was played. And then the last card you play has a number on it that says how many tricks you have to have won in order to score a point. So it's not like it was like weird and wacky, but it was a nice little twist on trick taking. That like when I first started reading the rule book, I was like, this sounds kind of dumb. And by the end, I'm like, this sounds kind of cool. And so we played a little like truncated game of it at the end of, we had like a little Christmas get together. And so it was good. I love trick taking. So it was a nice little familiar, but had a little twist to it. It was a lot of fun. I think it was a Kickstarter that TK got. So that was a fun little one. Cool. I'm not playing anything too weird and wacky here lately though. So I need to get on that.
I would say that would probably be my most recent one. I tend to play test a lot more than I do play published games, just because I love play testing process. So I haven't done much recently because we've been, you know, really working a ton on Galactic Cruise stuff, getting it ready. But like over the last few years, I would, you know, play test 3 or 4 or 5 times a week, other people's stuff. Like I love playing other people's games. And so something that felt weird to me just because of my play style is we had a kind of a designer retreat a few months back, and I played this game. It was kind of based on diplomacy. I'd never played diplomacy. That's not really my style of game. But it was kind of like a more Euro-y kind of different way to get point salad as opposed to just the normal way. I think that diplomacy doesn't, it was really cool. It was just a play test. We were just testing out a brand new design. But that was interesting to me because I'm not somebody who loves to like talk while I'm playing games. I just want to keep my head down and focus on what I'm doing. So like, as far as experiences go, that was pretty weird for me. But I did enjoy it. So it was cool.
So the last time I actually got to sit down and play Galactic Cruise was January, almost a year ago. I don't know that there's been a lot of mechanical changes, but it felt a little bit heads down to me. Is that accurate, or how would you describe the game to people?
So usually what I try to, like in a quick description of that element of the game, I try to say we try to strike a good balance of multiplayer solitaire and player interaction, which I know those two usually don't go together. It's usually one or the other. And so kind of as Koltin mentioned earlier, like with some of those systems in the game, like we really want people to feel engaged, right? Because it is a heavy game, because your turns are long, just like a heavy game. When it's not your turn, we want you to be engaged and be able to think about what you're doing. And so there are several things in the game that we've done to create that atmosphere. One of them is no blocking on the worker placement spots. And so the only player that blocks you is yourself. So you can bump somebody if you want to go where they're at. They get the worker back in a bonus, but you can do what you want to do. And that's a big thing in the game because when it's not your turn, you can plan out what you want to do on your turn. And when it gets to your turn, you can still do it no matter what. Nobody's going to stop you from doing what you want to do. Like there are a few small elements that might shift your focus, but for the most part, the game allows you to create that really long strategy for the whole game. And so when it's not your turn, you really get to think about that. And so, yes, your head is down looking at your stuff, but you're never disengaged or trying to minimize that disengagement. But those other systems that Colt mentioned, like when somebody takes cards or takes resources, then on your turn, you can come and refill them. So if Dennis does that on his turn, I'm paying attention to that because maybe I need money and he's just giving me a great opportunity to get it. Then there's also that bumping, right? If you bump me when it's not my turn, I get my worker back. That gives me something I didn't have. So now I can shift my plans a little bit. So it is kind of your multiplayer solitaire in the aspect of I'm doing my own thing. But other people can influence it in a positive way, which keeps you engaged with the other players and what they're doing. And so that's kind of where we try to strike that balance of that multiplayer solitaire and player interaction.
I do remember liking that I was never blocked out of something I wanted to do versus like I hadn't played on Mars in quite a while. And then I sat down with somebody who had played on Mars recently and I hadn't played it in quite a while. And that game punishes you a lot if you don't get to do the thing that you had been planning for. So yeah, that's nice. Who else might look at the game and be like, this is too heavy. But like, I think Koltin mentioned it. Even though it's heavy, there's some things that still lead you through a turn. So who else might this game appeal to?
One of y'all can speak to that if you want.
Yeah. So I think what's what we have tried to do is make onboarding as easy as possible. So like in our rule book, there are going to be, or there is in our work in progress rule book, some steps for your first game versus your, you know, your subsequent, like more full on games. we've also put in like little pieces of advice or, you know, here's some key concepts. And then every player has an 8-page employee handbook, basically like a fairly exhaustive player aid of like, if there is a question, it should be able to be answered for you right there. Another thing we've done is eliminate any closed information in the game. So like any cards that you acquired during the game can go to your hand, but they were drafted face up from the table. So at no point are you having to be like, I have this card in my hand and I don't know what it means. Can I kind of show it to you? But because it's like everyone saw you take it. Mm-hmm. So while it was out there, you could have said, you could have asked, you know, what does this card do? How do I use this card? Mm-hmm. So I think it very much helps players who are maybe a little shakier on it, or maybe who haven't played heavy, you know, games on the heavy end. They can feel a little more comfortable because they're not having to wade through it alone. Like they can, mm-hmm. because all the information's open.
And I also think theme plays a lot into that too.
Yes.
Right, that onboarding. Absolutely. Like that's something we hear a lot about, is just because everything makes sense. It's much easier to internalize. We often say that we're trying to make it thematically intuitive, right? So that some stuff just makes sense. And so that's kind of what I kind of talked about earlier when I was like removing things but adding them back only if they make sense. And so I think that also helps that onboarding process, mm-hmm. Of the people who may be scared to approach a heavy game. Of course, there's a lot of iconography, you know, the front loading does feel heavy, but once you start the process, it does tend to get pretty easy compared to some of those heavier games. Like we've had a lot of people mention that, you know, once you launch a shuttle, you kind of understand the process, right? You're getting resources, you're building your ship, you're scheduling a trip, you're selling tickets to the guest, and then you launch. And once you've done that once, then you've got the process, right? It's kind of procedural. And so throughout the game, you're doing that 3, 4, 5, 6 times. And so, you know, by, you know, halfway through the game, you feel like you've kind of got that process. And so I think that theme kind of really helps with that approachability for those people who are a little afraid of that heavier weight of game.
Yeah, because... go ahead.
Okay. I think something else that Chris said initially was something that came to my mind, just how, you know, other heavier games could be pretty punishing. And nothing in Galactic Cruise is really punishing. So a lot of games, you know, like you want to have the economy be tight enough that it's interesting. You don't just have like infinite resources and things like that. But there's always a way to get something. And there's usually multiple ways of getting something. And so like some of my favorite games are, like you mentioned, like a Lacerda or say a Splatter game. Mm-hmm. And they're great, but it's like they're so punishing to new players.
Yeah.
And so I enjoy that sort of thing, and I don't mind learning the hard way sort of thing as I play the game. But I think a lot of people don't like that, or it's like way more accessible to have somebody try this game. It is still complex, and you'll be able to do better later on, but it's not like you're gonna step on this landmine that was put there. Like sometimes I'm kind of wondering, I was like, did they do this on purpose just to like teach you, hey, don't do that, like don't try to do that thing as your first turn next time, like, you know, that wrecked your whole game and now you got to wait 3 hours for the game to be over. So it's
have
like,
you played Horseless Carriage?
I have it, but I have not played it yet. Is there stuff okay like that in there?
Well, so your factory gets set up, and then once it's there, you might be stuck with things that are completely useless later on. Like,
exactly. Yeah. sounds just like a Splatter. So it's like,
yep.
I bet I'm gonna love that. I've been meaning to get that one to the table, but haven't played it yet.
Okay.
But yeah, exactly. It's like that sort of thing where, you know, they might set up interesting things and choices and all that, but it's like, it can be very punishing to new players. Whereas Galactic Cruise is very welcoming to new players, and you'll be doing the same things. Like you'll still be launching your shuttle and all that. It's just that, people that know it better, or, you know, the next time you play, you'll be able to do all that more efficiently. So there's still all the interesting things, for me anyway, about the really heavy games. Like there's this big puzzle for me to figure out what's the best way. How can I launch the most times? How can I accomplish the company goals before Koltin or whatever? But it's not like punishing in any way. So new players can come in and still do all those same things and learn the game without just feeling like they're getting beat on every time. Like pretty much everything you do in the game, it's like, it all feels great. It's like, I'm getting something. I'm getting this. I'm getting resources. Somebody bumped me. I'm getting something. Give me a worker back. If I'm doing my recall turn, which we call, it's calling a meeting. It's like, I get resources as well as I get to take an action still. So it's like, they're not, we don't punish you for exploring the systems. So I think that would be my number one thing of like what makes it maybe easier, lighter. But I mean, again, 100% everything that TK and Koltin just said as well, like the theme makes it easier and all that. But I think it's that a lot of heavy games are kind of punishing on purpose. And some people love that. But I think it's maybe, you know, limiting a lot of the audience of those games by doing that.
So returning to theme and setting, the artwork looks great. I like the updates that I think TK has put a lot out there over the last year, just sharing more and more. Where would each one of you go if you were going on a Galactic Cruise in the game? I mean, maybe it wouldn't have to be in the game, but somewhere in our solar system.
So I'm a huge SpaceX fan. Like I love, like that's where the theme came from. Like just my love of just space and space travel. And like we all of us love cruises too. And so just that combination is just a home run for me, like theme wise, personally, I love it. And so I've always wanted to go to the moon or go to Mars. Like I love watching that progress and watching the, you know, the second launch of the Starship and the third that's coming up. And like, I love that. And so I would, you know, definitely moon, Mars, if that ever, you know, came available. In the game, I would go to the adventurous destination. That would be where I would want to go to and ride those. What the rovers? What do we call them? I can't remember what they're called.
Sand rovers, dune rovers.
Sand rovers, like something, yeah.
Yeah, I think for me, it's like, I don't know, the moon has always been, like, I know that, like, Mars is, like, the new, like, exciting place to go in our minds, but, like, there's, like, the moon feels classic. It's like, we go to the moon because we can see it every night, you know. You know, in sixth grade, you know, we had to study the moon phases. Like, the moon's like a part of us. So I would go to the moon. And then while I was there, I would visit our relaxing destination, have all those little serve you robots come up and take my order while I, you know, enjoy my drink in the little pools there. It's actually my current phone screensaver.
Oh, that's so there. Great. Because mine is the adventurous.
Is our relaxing destination.
So you're showing the artwork there, which people can find by going to Kinson Key Games, I'm guessing.
KinsonKeyGames.com is our website. Yep. And then, you know, we've got our BGG page up that's got all of the art reveals and everything there.
And then all of our social media as well. Actually, funnily enough, little Instagram spoiler, tomorrow it's going to be a picture of, it's the picture that TK sent me saying, I think the game's about to change, where he sent me his first location network.
That's cool.
I think that's going up tomorrow. So
nice.
Very cool.
Right, well, my answer for the destination is basically the same as TK, so we don't need to spend too much time on it. I think just going to space would be amazing. So in like reality, anything related to space would be amazing. But in terms of the game, I'd love to go to those little dune buggies, whatever we actually called them in the write-up. Those look awesome, so I would go to the adventurous destination.
Cool. Well, anything else that you all want to say about the game? as far as just when are you launching? When will people be able to start putting their order in for it?
So publicly right now, I think all we've said is Q1 of next year.
Okay.
So we're aiming for around March. I think probably at the beginning of January, we'll probably announce the official date, but should be around March sometime next year.
Cool. And are there other things people should be looking for? Like is there, you mentioned your Instagram, you mentioned the website, other things that people should be looking for as far as to find out more about the game?
Yeah, so we do have a Facebook group. You can just Google Galactic Cruise board game on Facebook. We've got like a private Facebook group you can join. That's kind of like our first level of revealing stuff. That's where when we do new art, we do new updates. That's the first place we go to. And then that kind of trickles to our Discord, which we're on there as well. And then our Instagram. And I think if you jump on our email list, which is just at kinsonkeygames.com, you get a welcome email that has other links to places if you want to join any of our communities. But I think, like you mentioned, we do have our Kickstarter page, pre-launch page up that you can follow along as well.
Very cool.
Yeah, if you want to actually play the game with us, we play on Tabletop Simulator. You can join our Discord for that. We run games in there, as well as other. Now it's kind of open to everyone that anybody can just organize their own game if they just want to play. And then, you know, closer to the Kickstarter, we'll have like a public mod you can download. But right now, if you just join our Discord, you'll be able to play on there.
Cool. And that's just on Tabletop Simulator. You're not doing Tabletopia or anything else?
Yeah, currently just TTS.
Okay. Yeah.
But we will get it up on Tabletopia, probably Board Game Arena, as many as we can. I think right now, once we get the art finished and like all the assets are done, we'll put it up everywhere. But right now, where we're having to like update everything, you know, every few days or week, we just have it up on one of those platforms. But by the time we launch, they should be up on most all of them.
Okay. Well, let's end with this question then for each of you, and however long you want to take to answer it, now that we have a little bit more time. Originally, we weren't sure how long this was going to go, but what is the biggest challenge with the game, this game design in particular, that you would never want to see again, and why? So what gave you a lot of trouble? You were like, that was dumb. I don't want to touch that again. And how did you overcome it?
So mine would probably be, it's kind of weird because I don't want to touch it again, is more of just like, don't do that again. And that's going to be underestimate the amount of time it takes and trying to do too much too fast. Because like when we started the game, I think, like we said, it was May, I believe, of 21. I think we said we were going to launch October of 22. Like that was our goal. Kickstarter, October 22. And then it was like, oh, well, maybe it'll be in the spring of 23. And it's like, no, it's going to be October of 23. Like, no, it's going to be spring of 24. And so I think just along the way, we just learned to kind of slow down and kind of do everything correctly, or not necessarily correctly, but try to do everything the right way. By getting wisdom from people and you know, not just trying to do things too fast. And so I think going forward, as we make new games, I think we're going to continue that approach. Instead of just trying to jump in the deep end, throw up the Kickstarter as soon as we can, you know, hurry up and get it done, it's going to be take our time, slow down. And so I think that was a lesson that Colton and I especially learned that first year of like, all right, this is not going to happen in a year. This is going to take a while. Let's slow down. Let's do it right. And so I think for me, that was kind of a big challenge to work through and kind of convince myself that like, okay, you don't have to rush it, right? Like the game is still going to be relevant. The thing's still going to be relevant in 3 years. It's not something we have to get out right now. And so I think that for me, that was kind of hard to get through, but something we'll definitely take forward.
Yeah, mine's kind of along the same lines. It's like the... It's like I never want to dip back to the level of inexperience. Like I know that whatever the next project is, like we don't want to rush it, but it will probably go a little faster because we know, you know, not to make dumb or like suboptimal mistakes. Yeah, I like that, you know, Jay Cormier's whole thing that like fail faster. Yeah, if you can fail faster each time, you get to the good stuff. and also not trying to knowing what your game is, not trying to kitchen sink it. At one point, you know, Galactic Cruise had secret goals and dice. Sometimes they were rolled, sometimes they were not rolled. There were blind draws, and there were at one point there was an auction mechanic in it. It's like taking all that stuff out. Who knows how much time and effort we put into making those assets that never should have made it in the first place. So like going forward, you know, in future designs, kind of filtering those things out more quickly so we can get to the good stuff. But I wouldn't trade any of that stuff in for anything, because it was very valuable this time around.
I think TK and Koltin hit it on the head with kind of the more bigger picture items. But the thing that kind of came to mind specifically of like a certain part of the game that kind of took the longest and had the most iterations, I think that was how the guests work. It felt like we did, like even this year, we just did so many different versions of that, and they always worked fine. But there was like this feeling that I'm like, something's just not quite there. And I think we all felt it, but like, it's like, there's not even anything wrong that I could say, no, like clearly this doesn't work, but just, it was like, it works. Okay. Okay. And it like took a long time for it to actually be like, you know what? This is actually, we don't need to touch it anymore. This is actually great. So that specifically took like a lot of iterations before we were all happy with how the whole guest system worked.
I think that was a big thematic piece, right? Like, we just kind of sat down and we're just, you know, if this was real life, how would guests work? You know, how would this system work in real life? And so just a quick overview of how it works now is the guests stand in line. They get set up at the start of the game. And then when you sell a ticket, like, you're going to gain reputation if you send them where they want to go, and you make money by selling them a ticket, because that's how you would get money in the real cruise industry, is selling tickets. And then when you launch, you advertise for a new cruise that comes out. All the people who are interested in it move forward in the queue, and new ones come out that match the new one. Because if a new cruise was advertised online, the people who are most interested in it would become more interested, and new people would show up. And so just, you know, we really pulled back and we're just like, how would this function? Even then, we tried a few different ways, because I mean, there's some things you do have to abstract. Like, everything can't be just how it is in the real world. But as much as we wanted it to be, that was a big piece of that thematic pull in and put back in.
I think one thing that I think we talked about earlier is like, who is this game for? Who does it appeal to? And I think because we asked that question so much, like, how would this work in real life, and then kind of gamified it, I think that even if people are not heavy, you know, mid-heavy gamers, which is kind of our primary audience, mm-hmm. but people are really into the theme, whether it's the space part or the cruise part, I think there is a certain intuitiveness to it, where like, people would be like, oh, that makes sense. It's not, I trade pottery for wine and they turn wine into action points. It's like, oh, I get fuel and oxygen and food because that's what a ship needs. Mm-hmm. And I have to build the ship because that makes, like, I think because we ask so often, like, what happens in real life, it makes people who enjoy this stuff in real life understand the game a little better. Like, even when I show it to my family who prefers, you know, much more like, you know, light to medium mm-hmm. games, they were like, hey, there's a lot going on here, but it all makes sense. I think like, jumping into our future designs with that mentality is going to be, you know, paramount for the future.
Very cool. Well, thank you all. I hope you have a great night. Appreciate your time, and I'm looking forward.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely.
Anything else anybody wants to say before we go? Okay.
I think we're good.
Okay, just want to make sure. Okay, but yeah, thanks, and we'll be looking forward to Galactic Cruise coming out in 2024, as long as no other big changes happen to the game. Hopefully not. All right.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks.
All right, thank you.